Welcome. Good evening indeed. I'm Stephen Colvin, the global head of Bloomberg Live, which is Bloomberg Media's live event division. I'm delighted to welcome you to this exciting installment of Cornell Tech at Bloomberg, a monthly series of talks that feature luminaries from the global tech community discussing the most pressing issues in technology today. This series is a collaboration, obviously, between Cornell Tech and Bloomberg LP that brings together Bloomberg employees and members of the Cornell tech community, as well as members of the greater New York City technology community. So an important gathering, to say the least. Now, the goal of this monthly series is to provide the opportunity to learn more about what notable entrepreneurs, investors, and technologists are thinking. And tonight, I'm certainly delighted to welcome as our guest speaker someone who embodies all three of these disciplines, an entrepreneur, an investor, and a technologist, Mr. Ben Lerer. And I'm privileged to say that Ben has been a friend of mine for about 10 years, so it gives me great pleasure to introduce him this evening. Ben is the CEO of Group 9 Media, a new digital media holding company consisting of Thrillist, Now This, The Dodo, and Seeker. He was also co-founder of Thrillist, as an FYI. He is a managing partner of Lerer Hippo Ventures, one of New York's most active and successful early stage venture capital firms, with early stage investments in the likes of Warby Parker, Giphy, Oscar, Casper, BuzzFeed, Refinery29, and many, many, many more great investments. Ben has received too many accolades to mention all of them, but suffice to say that he was among Ernst & Young's 2013 Entrepreneurs of the Year, Vanity Fair's Next Establishment, and Forbes' list of most powerful CEOs under 40. And importantly, Ben chairs the board of directors for Urban Upbound, a New York nonprofit organization, and is associate member of the International Academy of Digital Arts and Sciences. He sits on the board of directors for Casper, the advisory board for Refinery29, the board of Raised by Us, and is the chairman of the board of directors for Jack Threads. He is also an active member of the New York City venture community TechStars and Institute. Now, tonight, it's not only Ben that we're welcoming to the stage. I'm also delighted to welcome Bloomberg's very own Scarlett Fu, who will be talking to Ben about his entrepreneurial journey. You can see Scarlett on Bloomberg Television for 3 hours every weekday as the anchor of our flagship programs, Bloomberg Markets, followed by What You Miss. Based in New York, Scarlett has moderated discussion panels and interviewed business and political leaders from Bloomberg Television for Bloomberg Television, including Indra Nooyi, CEO of PepsiCo, and Tony Blair, the former UK Prime Minister. Before joining Bloomberg Television in 2017, Scarlett was a U.S. stocks editor for Bloomberg News, and prior to that, she oversaw Bloomberg News coverage of Asian equities and reported on the handover of Hong Kong to Chinese rule in 1997. She graduated Phi Beta Kappa from none other than Cornell University with a bachelor's degree in history and concentration in Asian American studies. So please now join me in welcoming Scarlett and Ben for this conversation.
Thank you for the introduction. Ben, thrilled to have you here. Thank you for joining us. Let's get straight to it. Let's start with your baby, which is Thrillist.
You have three children, yes, this is true.
My kids are my babies.
The original baby, how about that?
Okay, fine.
Back in 2004, before there was Facebook, before there was social media, you launched this niche email newsletter that gave New York City lifestyle recommendations. How would you describe it now?
Very differently. so that's 11 years ago, I think, which is terrifying. And I think how long we've known each other. Stephen was one of the first people. By the way, that introduction was so awkward and awesome. Thank you. But 11 years ago, there is no social media. Like, Facebook does not exist, and so we thought we were incredibly innovative and tech savvy in launching an email newsletter to distribute content.
Back then, you were.
I suppose we were really just copying Daily Candy. But I think the rules of media and the ecosystem has been flipped totally upside down multiple times over the last decade. I think the biggest flip is sort of in progress right now, which is the flip that's happening and sort of the disruption that I think is coming to television.
Mm-hmm.
Not that television is dead and or dying overnight, but I really do look at the role that Facebook and Snapchat and YouTube and to a lesser extent Instagram and Twitter and the role that they play in society today. They feel like the MVPDs, the sort of cable pipes from 3 decades ago. And so today, Thrillist is a brand that is trying to be building a new cable network,
mm-hmm.
A cable network that's distributed through the new pipes rather than the traditional cable pipes. And so that's how I would like to think of Thrillist, and we have a lot of work to do to sort of recognize that vision, but that's what we're going after.
All right, and so the journey to get there has been kind of zigzaggy, right? I mean, a lot of unexpected
yes.
turns. Everyone needs to reach into TV now, but not so long ago, the big idea was to combine e-commerce and content.
Yep.
And in 2010, you bought Jack Threads,
yep.
right? A flash sales site. You had told me that you approached this combination with some degree of naivete.
Yes. A spectacular amount, as I have approached almost everything that I've done in my life. Yeah, so we were building Thrillist. We were building an audience, and at that point, Thrillist was sort of for dudes. And today, Thrillist is less for dudes and more for people who like to do fun things. Thrillist had a big audience of people who did the things that we suggested. So we'd write about a restaurant, and people would go, or we'd write about a clothing store, and people would buy shit. And we took that relationship to sort of represent a kind of trust that we weren't necessarily getting credit for in the business model, the advertising business model that was sort of what the company had been founded on. And
mm-hmm.
we had a belief that we should find ways to take advantage of that relationship. And so Jack Threads, who had been a very small advertiser, but a very successful advertiser in converting our readers into their buyers, was something that we went out and bought as a way to see if we could find new revenue. We certainly did. In fact, we saw a lot, so much new revenue that it became, in many ways, the primary focus of the business. But we soon found out that wasn't who we were as
mm-hmm.
managers. So we had to build a secondary management team and the cash needs of the two businesses were totally different. Thrillist became less for men and more gender neutral, and sort of the businesses ended up growing apart, but within one cap table. And it was a few years ago that we went out to raise money for the combined entity, where, frankly, the market sort of, you know, hit me across the face and said, "Hey, buddy, these are two separate businesses. They're both real businesses, but they're different." And there was a certain set of people who I think really understood our media business and understood our vision for our media business, and the same for Jack Threads. And so we spun Jack Threads off into a totally independent, separate company and sort of went and redoubled our efforts to build a media company, which is sort of where my heart and interest has always been.
You had mentioned that you were hoping with this combination it would be 1 + 1 = 3.
Yes.
It wasn't 1 + 1 = 3. It was more like 1 + 1 =
1.5.
1.5.
I would say is probably the math. But that was because that was in investors' eyes. So
mm-hmm.
you would have a tech, like a media investor, of which there's like 3 in the whole world, because it's a really hard business.
And they're all in New York.
Right, and like it's like really hard to raise money for a media company. But the folks who were looking at our media business liked what we were doing and liked how we thought about the world and the direction that it was going, but they saw commerce, and frankly, it was the way that we did commerce. I think that media and commerce live beautifully together, and that media companies' core asset is trust with and access to an audience.
Mm-hmm.
And their businesses, media businesses, are in large part based on many brands paying them lots of money to access that audience. And so the idea that you, as a media company, would own a business that directly monetized that audience makes plenty of sense. The brand Thrillist and the brand Jack Threads had less and less to do with one another as time went on, and Jack Threads took a path forward that many of the companies we've invested in to great success or great failure have taken, which is they built real vertically integrated commerce, designing clothing, shipping stuff. Like, they built a retail enterprise,
mm-hmm.
and that takes a lot of money and a lot of focus and a lot of expertise. none of which we had. And so we realized that we, you know, like the game of whack-a-mole that anyone plays when they build a business, like you're focused on something and then some other shit breaks. And we had way too many moles and not enough clubs to handle the two businesses. And so I think commerce will be a part of Group 9. Absolutely. I don't think commerce, where we hold inventory, will be something that we'll do in the early stages of exploring monetization through direct sales. But the idea that, particularly in a digital world, that these large audiences that you can sort of, and the data that you have and the understanding that you have of these audiences, the fact that, you know, like there is a way to create value not only through advertising, a bunch of ways.
Now, people who like your media business like it a lot, and that includes Discovery, because last year they made a $100 million investment in Thrillist, and companies run by your sister, as well as those backed by your father, and you created Group 9 Media.
Yeah.
How did that investment come about?
Well, so Group 9 was an idea that was based on a little bit of sort of studying history. We really did go and look at sort of the last giant media, like the last giant disruption and the rise of cable. It was not, it's not a like a really hard story to sort of understand and track, which is the cable pipes became dominant. The number of cable subscribers in the U.S. went from 0 to 50 million over the course of a decade. Mm-hmm. And suddenly, and consumer behavior changed, and people spent all night sitting in front of the TV consuming content, and it created an opportunity for all these vertical networks to arise. And so everyone from ESPN to CNN to MTV, like every big cable network, generally speaking, launched within 12 years of each other. And what ended up happening is, as has happened in sort of every generation of media, they ended up consolidating. And they formed Scripps, and they formed Viacom, and they formed Time Warner, and they formed Disney's cable business, and they formed Discovery Communications. And this has happened in print, and this has happened in the newspaper business, and like this always happens. Consolidation comes so that you have more leverage with the people who distribute your content, better advertiser solutions at scale, and some financial leverage and learnings and other things, you know, to oversimplify. And we looked at what's happening right now in digital media, specifically around this massive shift to video within all the dominant video, all the dominant digital pipes. The fact that most traditional media companies have spent the last decade investing in stock buybacks rather than truly leaning in to digital, because you know the digital, you know, cents versus traditional dollars, that was the case. But I think as the TV business is starting to show some signs of weakness, mm-hmm. not that it's going away overnight. Mm-hmm. I always say this, particularly in a building where there's a TV network and people are scary.
Scary.
but like there are headwinds that you know cable is facing. I think a thinning bundle, I think more than anything, attention from millennials. Mm-hmm. You know, the phone is in many ways the first screen for people who didn't grow up tethered to a cable subscription. The idea that through these new sets of pipes there are opportunities to build the new MTV, the new ESPN, the new whatever, and they don't have to be digital versions of those, but they have to be brands that make awesome content built for the format that people consume in. And so as short form video becomes an increasingly big part of our media diet, the idea was how do we find brands that are leading in short form video in categories that we think are big and important, and that are becoming increasingly important culturally, mm-hmm. where we can go and instead of being one of 50 or 60 digital media businesses in the wind, as Thrillist was, you go raise money every 2 years, you do the, you know, and we were on the larger side of that equation, but still. It's a rat race. It sucks. You're just like one of, you know, like you're not a must-buy for any advertiser or for almost any advertiser. You aren't necessarily able to go and attract the absolute top tier of talent. It's hard. And we said, is there a way that we can skip the line, mm-hmm. and that we can sort of put ourselves in a dominant position in the digital media landscape how do we identify other properties that we think are doing this right? And we focused our attention on brands that had massive reach on distributed platforms. And because of the investing that we do at LHV, we were early investors, sort of incubated two companies, one of which is my sister's company called The Dodo, which is the leading animal media brand on the internet, about 1.5 billion monthly video views, the Snapchat Discover channel for animals, the second biggest Facebook audience in the US behind Tasty. Mm-hmm. They had built this amazing community in a category that we thought was really on the rise. Like, how many people here don't know who Harambe is? No one. Good. You're all nice people. But that, like, that is a new cultural phenomenon. And there are more pets than there are children in the United States. Mm. Look at the way that people self-identify on Twitter and on Facebook. Like, Ben, I work in media, I have two kids and a dog, and I like the Mets. Like, it's sports for more people than sports.
That's a great way to put it.
And so we looked at it and said, this is a giant opportunity of a huge potential business. Okay, put a pin in it. And then another business that we had founded at LHV that had sort of been my father's brainchild, although had been run by a team that we had built and sort of funded, was now this, which is the leading social news brand in the world. Mm-hmm. Almost 3 billion monthly video views, another Snapchat Discover channel, the fastest growing, you know, millennial media audience in the world. And we said, well, look, we've got these two brands that are dominant from a scale perspective and that dream in video. We have Thrillist, which has a bunch of infrastructure around within the advertising community, within branded content creation, a big O&O audience, a massive desire and need to get not sort of into video and like build a video team, but to become a brand that dreams in video. And we said, how do we put these three things together to create something that has real heft? We went out, we talked to Discovery, and Discovery said, we're all in. We sort of see the changes the same way that you do. Mm-hmm. And in fact, we've been building a brand here in its early stages called Seeker that was really built on YouTube, but had built a big audience in the science category. And they said, you guys are sort of better at building these digital businesses than we are, the same way we're better at building linear cable nets than you. Mm-hmm. Why don't we partner? We'll contribute this in addition to capital, and this will be the fourth brand, and the science brand, and really the VR brand is how we're sort of thinking about Seeker. And so we put that deal together, announced it in October, closed it in December, and we're sort of working a lot, putting these things together. It's incredibly hard, but it's
now clear. It's the non-glamorous part.
It is the least glamorous thing I've ever done. It's super duper hard culturally, mm-hmm. to take four different cultures of really dynamic, smart people, mm-hmm. to not be overly prescriptive about what lives at the brand level and what lives at corporate. Mm-hmm. It is really hard, but it is totally the right thing to do. That this is absolutely everything that we hoped is coming true, but it's tough because we are trying to do something that we haven't really seen done, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. since cable consolidation.
So that being the case, are you free of the rat race completely, or do you still have to go out and pitch investors? I mean, maybe not since October, but do you see that in your future?
I think we'll raise more capital in the future. Mm-hmm. For a few reasons. One is, there's genuine ambition here, unlike anything that I've ever been a part of. I haven't been that ambitious, but like, I think that we can build something legitimately massive. Uh-huh. I'm really thinking about this in sort of a longer term view than I traditionally did. I think a lot of startups are always in the mode of sort of putting lipstick on the pig. And for those of you who have founded companies or who, like, you understand what that means, which is at all times you're sort of like in the messy world of building your business, you're trying to make it like look nice for investors and potential buyers just in case someone shows up. And that's distracting, mm-hmm. and takes a bunch of energy and is probably not the best thing for the business. And so we're not in lipstick mode at all, maybe for the first time ever. We're just building, and it's like a little messy, but it's all, we're focused on the right stuff, and we have a real strategy and a real long-term view. So I think that we'll want more capital over time to invest into the brands that we have now and to continue to build new formats of content and help those brands get to creating a bunch of longer form stuff and really sort of becoming brands. Like when someone uses the word vertical at Group 9, we are like, don't do that. Call it a brand. Like we're building brands. And that means that how do these brands manifest themselves offline? What are the commerce opportunities? What are the various partnerships? What are the international aspirations? And they don't have to be the same for every brand. And so we need money for that. I also think the opportunity to have more than four brands is a real one. Mm-hmm. I don't have brands right now that I've sort of identified and said that. Like that's the one that I want. But because of LHV on the investing side, we invest in media companies with more regularity than any other sort of earlier mid-stage firm. So we have a good sense of the ecosystem. We know who's doing the right stuff and the wrong stuff and who's having success. And so I think that's an interesting source of education and deal flow. So we would want capital for that. And I also have a belief that, and I'm stealing this from something that years ago Andrew Creighton at Vice said to me, which I thought was brilliant, and I think they've actually done a pretty good job of doing, which is think of ways to turn your cost centers into profit centers. And so how do we think about the agency, the creative agency, and the services that we provide to our clients that sit at sort of the core of Group 9 within our ad sales group? How do we think about that not being a group of services that only runs media and content that lives within our brands, but how do we think about using the insights and the sort of learnings that we have from living at the cutting edge of media of creation distribution and use that to build a profitable, self-sustaining services business? Or how do we think about the technology platform that we've built that powers the content creation and distribution and insights for all of our brands and how we might be able to activate that for other partners, whether they're brands, whether they're agencies, whether they're other media businesses. And I think the Washington Post has done a really beautiful job of doing that and investing in that over the last few years. So we look around at what all the different opportunities. I think right now the key is focus and not to sort of try to boil the ocean, because we could easily get, we could try to do too many things and screw it up. Mm-hmm. But the overarching aspiration is to not have four good digital brands. It's to do something bigger that will cost more money and that hopefully will be worth more money.
And the brands will, of course, attract their advertising dollars as well.
And they'll do that at in a bunch of ways. They'll do that at through a sort of a centralized go-to-market, so that the biggest brands and agencies have one touch point for us, although we'll then have to come up with very strategic, creative, sort of differentiated solutions depending on the brands and which of our brands they want to be participating with. But then the big unlock, the big question mark is, and I really hope and believe that it is a when, not an if, places like Facebook become platforms where legitimate scaled monetization can happen for publishers. And I think Facebook and Google are sort of running right at each other right now. Mm-hmm. And if you think about where the next giant pocket of advertising is that neither of them are fully taking and owning, it's television. And I think that those two platforms, with sort of the dark horse of Snapchat emerging, creates an ecosystem where there's more competition, and I'll throw in the sort of like real wild cards of Amazon and Netflix, where there is ultimately more competition for great content. And where I believe that these platforms will create opportunities for us to make real money, not just to distribute branded content, and not just to sort of get a little bit of money for live and some things that are sort of like nice head nods to acknowledge that we're spending a lot of money on their platforms. I believe that there's a genuine desire and interest at those places to allow the best media businesses to build and the best video media businesses to build real businesses on those platforms. And so that is one of the fundamental focuses for the long-term monetization.
At the core of this is you believe TV is not dead. Despite all the obituaries being written about TV being dead, it is not dead. What does that mean for the future of traditional broadcasters and digital brands? Are you surprised that we're not seeing more roll-ups like the one that happened between the different brands that you run and Discovery?
I think you will see many more. I think there's
What's been the holdup so far, though?
Well, so the holdup so far has been, for a long time, the TV business has been much healthier than we would, you know, every year it's like the year that the other shoe's going to drop and then the shoe doesn't drop. So I think these businesses need to feel it a little more. Mm. I think the sort of the lightning rod that people are now pointing to is ESPN, because it's always been the healthiest TV business.
And the subscriptions are now slowing down.
And it's clear now there's enough of a pattern that it's not going to turn around. Mm. Not to say that ESPN isn't still the most spectacular brand and the most spectacular. I mean, like, I worship ESPN as a company, but
they're cutting jobs.
ESPN is going to get smaller, not bigger. Mm-hmm. Like, that's not, again, I don't think that that's my opinion. I think that that's a fact. And so in a world where some of the really big companies, you know, the Big 8 or the Big 10 or the Big 12 TV companies who sit on huge amounts of cash and still massively profitable businesses, there comes a time, and I believe Discovery investing in us is a indicator of that. I think what NBC has done with BuzzFeed is an indicator of that. I think even what Univision has done in buying The Onion and Gawker is an indicator of that. I think Complex selling to Verizon and Awesomeness selling to Verizon mm-hmm. is an indicator of that. Like, you are seeing deals get done. You are seeing consolidation happening with Time Warner and AT&T. You're seeing consolidation happening with Yahoo and AOL. I sort of think it's happening. I think, you know, there will be...
But Google, Facebook, Snapchat, they're kind of on the edges of it.
Well, Google, Facebook, and Snapchat aren't... They're distribution platforms. They're the MVPDs. They're Comcast. Now, eventually, Comcast bought NBC.
Correct.
And so... when does that happen? I think the answer is at some point. I'm not holding my breath for that as much as I am those brands, those platforms first creating monetization for publishers that they don't own and understanding what that looks like and what that feels like, and over time getting into that business. But it is far from inconceivable, I think, that those guys end up becoming content owners. I don't expect it to happen right now.
Okay. Let's switch gears a little bit. We talked about LHV, Lerer Hippo Ventures. And, of course, your father casts a pretty big shadow in Silicon Valley, right?
He's very fat.
I didn't quite mean it that way. Talk about your father. He's the co-founder of Huffington Post.
Yep.
Helped or hurt your business ambitions?
No. My father's my best friend. He helps my ambitions. He helps me a huge amount.
You've said he's a fan of nepotism?
I'm a fan of nepotism. I am, like, the biggest fan of nepotism. Nepotism generally works because really smart people generally have pretty smart kids. So, like, come on. So I think that my dad has been instrumental in helping me. He has a few life lessons. One of them that I appreciate is... he's taught me that everyone is a fraud. And by that I mean, whenever I feel insecure or concerned that I am losing control, he says, it's fine, so is everybody else. No one has any idea what the hell's going on. And I sort of believe that to be the case, not in a way that everyone's an idiot, but like, this is a crazy time. Technology is flipping the entire world upside down. If you work in media and you think you have a handle on it,
you don't.
You're screwed. You have no handle on it. If you work in retail and you think you have a handle on it, you don't. You're screwed. Like, the biggest businesses are being transformed right now. And so what he's done is basically he's infused me with confidence to try to, you know, like, try shit. He and I, we talk about business, but we talk about business much more in the sense of, he says, how was your day? And I say, oh, and he goes, no, I mean, how are your kids? And I'm like, oh, they're good. And he's like, okay, I don't want to talk about your company. Goodbye. When big decisions, the idea for Group 9 was definitely something that as that he and I had been cooking up for years with no meat on the bone. We mm-hmm. called it NewCo for mm-hmm. like 3 years. And it was just this idea that there needed to be a holding company and that consolidation was coming. That was his insight from having lived through a few of these. Mm-hmm. And he said to me, when I was, 20 something years old in 1980, whatever, I was working in the cable business and I saw that consolidation was going to be coming and I didn't have the access to capital or the confidence or the, whatever to do it. Mm-hmm. And I watched a bunch of people around me build these amazing things and I got to be a part of it and participate in it. But he said, you see this happening now. Why don't you do it? And I went through sort of a process of saying, look, I've built this great, what I thought of as a really good asset in Thrillist and this company that people were telling me was really valuable and that I could go and pursue things and maybe I could sell it and I could, and blah, blah, blah. And he inspired me to say, let it ride. Like, come on, have fun with this. Mm-hmm. Like, take advantage of a very unique time and a very unique opportunity and a unique position that you're in. There's not a lot of 35-year-olds who have been working in media and running a media company for 10 years. Mm-hmm. So, do it. And so that's where he has created nothing but opportunity for me, and I definitely do not feel hampered by him.
No, he allows you to take risks, and he
totally.
Gives you the confidence to do that. You graduated from UPenn Wharton. You're not an engineer.
Not Wharton.
Not Wharton. UPenn.
Couldn't get into Wharton.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No.
Bad fact checking
sorry.
On my part.
Barely got into Penn.
But you graduated from there.
I did get out of it.
Okay.
I made it out, although I still have a horrible nightmare every few months about not having passed my French test or something to that effect. But
that's okay. It's years past, right?
Okay.
You're not an engineer. You don't have a tech background.
Nope.
So what is the hardest part of the tech landscape to master? I mean, there's a lot of terminology, and you're around a lot of hardcore tech people.
Yeah, well, I mean, look, we've been doing this for a long time now, and I've been lucky to have had the first CTO, real CTO I ever hired, be someone that became sort of like a tech mentor to me, who I still have an incredibly close relationship with and who was with me for 7 years before going and working at another LHV company. And so I've had the benefit of getting what's really unique about him is he speaks both tech and English. And so he really, and I think what he taught me and really beyond him, just a belief that I have is, and we talked a little bit about this, technology makes anything possible. And so the answer should always be yes. And whatever we imagine to be possible because of technology can be. It doesn't necessarily mean you're always backing a team that actually has the skill to do it, mm-hmm. but crazy shit can be built. Look at the development, look at your phone and what that looked like a decade ago. Look at Tesla. Look at some of these companies and the things that they're doing are almost unimaginable. Mm-hmm. We're not investing in super hardcore tech. We're investing in companies that are tech-enabled for the most part. New York is not an amazing hub for technology. It's an amazing hub for finance. It's an amazing hub for fashion. It's an amazing hub for retail. It's an amazing hub for media. It's an amazing hub for advertising. It's not a hardcore tech town. Mm-hmm. And so the things that I'm drawn to are generally more around brands, generally more around content. Technology is an enabler. Mm-hmm. And so the challenges that our companies are trying to solve with technology are not even the most unimaginable, unbelievable tech challenges. And so I'm sort of the mind that tech, it's the great enabler, but anything can be created.
And of course, when you look at what's going on in Silicon Valley, there's been plenty of boom and bust cycles. I wonder, what effect does consolidation on the left coast mean for the New York tech scene? Does each convulsion in California necessarily mean that there's retrenchment here, even if New York is not the capital of technology, it's a good center for retail, for media,
yeah.
fashion?
Well, so retrenchment is dumb. Like, the best companies are built when the competition is retrenching and you invest through the downturn. That is That's just like how it gets done. And so I think that, you know, when a market is under fire, whatever market that is, that's also when the most opportunity exists. The reason that the digital media companies, the BuzzFeeds and the Vices and the Group Nines and the Refineries and the whatevers of the world exist is because traditional media retrenched. And digital and these companies got an opportunity mm-hmm. because what for pennies on the dollar, traditional media could have gone and filled this space and could have been at the leading edge of it, but they weren't. Because they were, because as a very big company, when disruption comes, I've been disrupted as a small company, mm-hmm. and it's really fucking hard. As a giant company, I imagine it is the most uncomfortable feeling in the entire world, and you have to have, you have to be fearless. Mm-hmm. And public companies are generally not rewarded for fearlessness in the short term. I just think retrenching, I think it's time to double down.
So given all that, where do you think we are in the tech cycle? Are we in a bubble right now?
Well, I think we are. I think the stock market mm-hmm. is, I don't quite understand, and regardless of people's political beliefs, I don't understand how the stock market is at the all-time high of highs when we have a sort of crazy person running the country. So
there's a disconnect there.
That's a little weird, right? That's a little weird. So I'm not like, I think, you know, I understand pro-business policies, but like, I think a lot of other factors, you know, have an effect on the market mm-hmm. and you know, geopolitical issues and things like that. You know, it's great that we're 50 days in and there haven't been any terrifying things that have happened. Like, I mean, there have been plenty of terrifying things that have happened, but I mean, there hasn't been like
a terrorist attack.
Like, you know, yeah. the things that are inevitable
yeah.
to happen. And so, yeah, I'm not like wanting to own a bunch of stocks right now. Mm-hmm. That being said, like Facebook, generationally, probably multi-generationally important, like magnificent, amazing company. Amazon, yes. Apple, yes. Google, yes. Like these are probably the greatest companies that have ever been built in the history of mankind. And so these are, I'm so long these companies and want to own these stocks and want to be associated with these businesses forever or mm-hmm. for you know, as long as I can imagine. Mm-hmm. But I think there's probably like a little too much heat in the stock market. I don't know that those companies per se are overvalued versus, I don't think they are. I think those companies are going to continue to grow and do fantastically well. But I think the stock market as a whole is like, there's just something feels a little off to me.
What do you think about Snapchat and it's going public? You know, it fell for a second day. Among the analysts that we've surveyed here at Bloomberg, there are 7 analysts and no one has a buy on it. Everyone has either a hold or a sell. Now that, of course, is also due to the fact that a lot of the banks that underwrote the IPO can't publish their opinions yet. They're in the quiet period.
Yeah.
They have to wait until they do that, and they're probably going to be more sympathetic. Nonetheless, what's your take on Snapchat? Is it going to be a profitable company?
I think yes. I think that it is not. And by the way, I'm as a Twitter user, I love Twitter, but I think that it's not Twitter as a business. I think that it's a better business than Twitter, mm-hmm. If for no other reason than advertising is a video business. Like the business of advertising is the business of video.
Mm-hmm.
And Snapchat is a platform that lives and breathes video. That is what it is, and that's not the sort of natural form factor for the Twitter experience. And so I think that that's just a giant limiting factor to the, I think Twitter's a great company. I think that the expectations on it are unfair. And so it gets beaten up when, like, maybe it's just not supposed to be a $20 billion company. Like,
maybe you should just confess to that it's a niche product.
Well, I mean, 300 million people use it. It's not that niche. There was a time 10 years ago where 300 million people represented, like, the greatest consolidation of audience in the history of mankind. But I don't think it's a niche, but it doesn't need to be a $20 billion company. Mm-hmm. There are a lot of really good $4 billion companies or $8 billion companies. I would like to build one of those. or invest in a single one of those as a startup. So I think Snapchat is real. I think Snapchat, you know, to become Facebook and to become Google, and you know, there's an ocean of work that needs to be done. But I think that the platform, I think that the product development that they do and the sort of feel for their audience is exquisite. I think that that the space that they can fill around really owning sort of one-to-one video communication or sort of small group communication is a space that Facebook has, for the most part, abandoned to become a to become the future of TV. And so I think that there's a place for them to build a really big business, and they're you know, we're big partners of theirs. We have two Discover channels, and I think that the way that they're building their advertising business around the auction is really smart, and the sort of self-service products that they're going to build, or that I believe that they'll build, are going to, I think it's going to be, you know, after Google and Facebook, the next place that brands spend scaled digital reach and frequency dollars online.
Now, put on your LHV hat for a moment. Yep. You also invest in startups. I know you're looking for a company like Snapchat. Everyone's looking for a company like Snapchat. Everyone's looking for the next big thing. How does that experience of evaluating other people's companies, what's the lesson that you've learned as an entrepreneur about how to invest in other people's companies? What kind of answers do you come prepared to offer?
Well, we're seed investors. I mean, I guess the definite, we're early stage investors, so we're really, like, we're really just investing in people.
Rather than concept.
Rather, you know, I mean, look, we'd like it if you, you know, hopefully a good concept, hopefully an actually launched business with plenty of good data. But it's really founding teams that are the number one focus. You know, fortunately, we are finding enough good teams, good products, whatever, so that we're not having to take, like,
one and sacrificing the other.
We're not having to make those sacrifices. Sometimes we choose to do that, but we're not in we're not investing in companies, really. We're investing in people, and so, you know, you meet a lot of people and you start to, it's like, it's not exactly dating, but like you sort of lean in or you lean back, right? You like them, you start to get a feel for it, you're buying what they're selling, you trust them, you share a vision, you have a common, you know, you have a feel for what they're doing that you think is smart. We see an incredible number of businesses. I mean, you know, thousands and thousands of companies a year. And I certainly don't see every single one of them, but our team, we process a huge amount of data, and good stuff rises. And the stuff that we tend to invest in stuff that we sort of understand or have some experience in, where we think we can help. And we've seen enough companies now where there are some telltale signs through pattern recognition, which is like the sort of silly investor thing to say, but through feel. Like, you know, I'm not smashing, you know, Excels looking at like the business model. The only thing I know about the business model is it's totally wrong. Because it's like a brand new startup, and like this is just not how it's going to go. So
it's organic. It's gut.
Yeah, I mean, for me, it's totally gut, and it is not hard. It is not particularly hard for me to make decisions about the things that I invest in. I don't like, you know, lay in bed like wondering if I should or shouldn't. I'm pretty decisive and let my gut drive, and so far that's, you know, Stephen was nice to mention some of our really good companies, which is awesome. We have plenty of not really good companies,
or soon to be good companies,
or soon to be not good companies. You know, we're in over 300 companies over the last 6 years, so we've got the full spectrum of like literal criminals to like the greatest people in the world, and. So we, you know, we like, don't tell anyone that.
It's a potpourri.
But we've seen it all. So, yeah. So, you know, I think generally speaking, more often than not, we're sort of right. And that's our business model.
I like the sort of right idea because as we wrap it up, before I open everything to questions and answers from the audience, your journey from newsletter to integrated e-commerce editorial content site to a holding company of brands, how much of that was by design? Clearly none of it?
Literally none at all. Ever.
It was all improvised.
Of course. First of all, look at, I mean, just like, all we were doing was trying to sort of move with the world and get the wind at our backs and be in the places where we thought that, like, the momentum was coming and where we would be able to create, you know, impact the largest number of people and set ourselves up for building the most, sort of the realest business. And there have been winds that have turned quickly and we've, you know, been blown off course. I'm using lots of, like, yachting references. I don't think that, like, if you were, if I were to go back 10 years, 11 years, and tell you what Thrillist looks like now, first of all, I would have, I mean, I can't explain how naive I was, and probably 10 years from now, how naive I will think I look right now, sounding the way that I sound. I mean, like, I still don't really have any idea what's going on, and, like, that's okay, because I don't think anyone else does either.
All right. And with that, let's open it up to questions from the audience. Gentleman over there with the baseball hat, sir.
Hi, that's great about the criminals.
Yeah.
Appreciate that. Still innocent.
Okay.
But anyway, if you talk about using your gut and seed capital, so people talk about putting together these 20-page decks and going to the venture capitalists. What would you say are the most important things? I know the team is so important, but in terms of preparing and what should be focused on when people are going to people like you?
It's a great question, and it's hard to, it's going to really depend on the team and on the business. I think the thing that we're generally looking for is a really clear, it's hard because it's a total contradiction, an incredibly concise, clear, firm belief in what you want to build and why it's right, and also a willingness to be open-minded and take feedback and be flexible. And my dad would call it an ability to pivot. That he looks for in somebody, an ability to sort of acknowledging that almost nothing we invest in ends up being what we invest in. He looks for someone who has that flexibility. I think I probably lean a little bit more towards looking for someone who has that conviction, but it's a balance of those two things that you want to show. And that means like real sort of unfair advantage to be the person building the business that you're building, which admittedly I did not have at all when I was building Thrillist. Like I had never done anything in media. I was like not a particularly good writer, and like I like just ate a lot of food. And
but you did that, you knew a lot of people.
I don't even know what I knew. I just like, it was a time where there was no one else starting companies in technology. So there was no noise. There's also no money available to raise, but that's a different story. So I think if you're starting something, like, why are you starting this is a really important thing to be able to no matter how that is presented, it should be consistent every time.
Thank you.
Yeah, of course.
Sir, in the front.
Hello, how you doing, Ben? I'm Benny with Bashani. I wanted to ask you a question. Do you think because of that gut feeling of not really knowing what you was capable of that contributed to your success, and how would that help you going forward, really not knowing what you're doing?
Well, I don't think not knowing what you're doing is particularly helpful. And I don't mean I don't actually, I have very strong beliefs that I know I'm doing. I think the point is that it's almost the same answer to the last question, just phrased very differently, which is I have an incredible conviction that I have a game plan that I'm executing and that is right. But, and I've shown this now a few times, I'm also willing to acknowledge when I'm not and pivot. And not thinking of pivot as a bad word, but thinking of it as a flexibility that sort of, it's a survival tactic, and you know, to thrive you need to survive. So, yeah.
All right, gentleman over there.
You seem to be pretty ahead of the curve as far as media and content. How do you feel about new emerging technologies like virtual reality and augmented reality? How soon do you jump into stuff like that?
Great question. So at Group 9, we're making a really big investment in it. One of our four brands, Seeker, is about half of the editorial investment of the brand is going to be in VR and AR. I think we're sort of all in. There's a few reasons for that. One is I do believe that it will be, I think it's too early. I think we're seeing that with sort of like the adoption of the actual headsets, and like it's slow to roll. We invested in a few companies about 2 years ago at LHV that like sort of have, if they haven't necessarily come and gone, but they've come and not arrived or something. I think it's still really early, but I do believe that it's that a decade from now, it's like a massive part of our media diet. So I tend to, and I think right now big brands are really drawn to it. And so there's an opportunity for us to experiment in it a bunch, get really good at it from a content creation perspective. And I think there'll be a business in it because brands want to experiment, and that'll be something that we'll be a leader in from sort of a helping brands understand that world. But I don't think the audiences will be enormous yet. I think it's more speculative. But you know, anytime I do a demo and I get in the experience, it's too incredible not to be something that is here to stay.
Is it more immersive? I mean, can you get yourself out of it?
Sometimes you almost throw up, but there's nothing more transporting in the whole world. And I think, and this is for me personally, but it's very hard in this world with this stupid thing to be present. Like in anything. I think about this with my kids. Mm-hmm. Like, how do I like actually just like live in the space that I'm in? And VR is a different kind of being present because it's being present in a virtual world. But that kind of experience is, there's something so appealing about being truly in a moment.
You're 100%
there. Yeah. That with no other stimuli. So I think that culturally that's like an important thing for people to do.
All right, gentlemen over here.
Be curious to hear your views about what's going on in Asia, in particular as it relates to some of the players that have aspirational desires to enter this market, as well as investment opportunities, and any thoughts on the SoftBank Fortress combination, which I think brings something new, which is venture together with credit and private equity.
Yep, very good question. My answer will be pretty dumb, because
SoftBank
I only have so much room to really know about stuff. I thought that deal was really interesting. It was sort of my understanding that's the first kind of deal like that that's ever happened, independent of sort of Asia and anything else like it. That private equity, that a company would be, that like a merger like that would exist. I don't know enough about Fortress's business to really speculate. And at LHV, again, one of our core principles is invest in what you understand and invest in what you know. And so we actually only invest in the US. So much of what we do is sort of consumer focused, or if B2B, B2B, that's like a half step from the consumer. And so we don't spend, we really are focused in this market because we can fully wrap our arms around it. And in fact, even in the US, a vast majority of the deals that we do, and almost all of our focus from a deal flow perspective is based on New York. I think that to do anything really well, you have to totally commit to it. And so our goal is to be the preeminent venture firm in New York City, focused on supporting businesses in New York City. I guess you could be like from the suburbs, but that's what we do. Sometimes our companies grow to, you know, and end up in other markets. Casper, which I'm on the board of, has expanded to Europe. And it's really interesting to learn about sort of the trials and tribulations that they're going through expanding there. But it also is a, sitting in those board meetings is a good reminder that I don't know anything. Mm. And so it's just not where we're really smart.
The woman over there?
Hi, Ben. Does it surprise you that newsletters are hot again, like what's happened with the Skim and all the other newsletter products that are coming from traditional media companies, having started there?
I love that question. No, and we've always been a believer in email and have continued to grow email. And I think email is an amazing tentacle for a media business from a distribution perspective. And I think it's I think email is still a very, email's another of those things. It was like, email's dead 10 years ago. It's like, email's not dead. Like, once you have a job, email will never be dead.
It'll rule your life.
Like, right. Like, but I think email, I think it's a really personal place. And I think that, some of my most some of my favorite media interactions happen in email, but I think the Skim girls are super smart, and again, they're a great example of being focused. They've decided to do one thing, and own it. That's what Thrillist was in the early days, and then we started doing a bunch of other stuff, and actually our email got sort of shitty, because we weren't really focused on it, and I think our email is. I still really enjoy Thrillist email, but there's still so much more that we can and should do with it. And I think the Skim is an example of when you really truly design for a pipe, how good an experience can be. I would say now, generally speaking, our pipe, the pipe that we're most focused on, would be Facebook. But I think email is still a totally viable one.
All right, final question for Ben, sir.
For traditional media companies, ad-supported media companies, they look at CPMs, they look at uniques, et cetera. And when you throw out numbers for Now This or for the Dodo at 3 billion video views or whatever, and I think it's like a CNBC maybe has 500,000 viewers on a given day.
Yeah.
You should be retired based on those numbers. So talk about the economics behind the ad-supported and why aren't you making gobs of money with 3 billion yeah. video views,
Well, so a lot of those video views are happening on Facebook and Snapchat and other platforms where the ad product. So, and I'm sure many of you know this, and this is all public information that Facebook is now sort of finally getting into testing placing ads within videos in the newsfeed. It's one of many announcements within sort of like all the things going on at Facebook, but for a company like ours, it is the first step in what we believe will be a bunch of steps that will lead to actually being properly compensated for being the most among the most popular publishers on the most important content distribution platform in the world.
So right now you're not properly compensated, would you say?
Right now, we're and Facebook wouldn't even pretend for a second that we're properly compensated. But I think that they are in good faith trying to figure out what that product looks like. And it's also unrealistic to pretend that 500,000 people watching a 30-minute program versus 4 billion views at more than 3 seconds is. It's hard to think of those things. Now, I can tell you, we have way more time spent at Now This than CNBC does. That is not a question. And I do believe that we should be able to make more money at Now This than CNBC. I don't think that that's going to happen today. Certainly, it's not happening today. I don't think that's going to happen in the very short term. But I think if we look 10 years from now, Now This will be a really big business. Yeah.
All right, thank you so much. And our thanks to Ben Lerer.
Thank you.
Co-founder of Thrillist and CEO of GroupMyMedia.
Thanks, guys.